By golly, it's amazing. It sounds like something you'd hear on the radio.
Presenting the Transcription feature.
The Lucky Strike program starring Jack Benny with Mary Livingston, Phil Harris, Rochester, Dennis Day, and yours truly, Don Wilson.
It's 8:30 New York time. Time to wake up America and stump the expert.
From Hollywood, it's time now for...
Johnny Dollar.
Kraft presents The Great Gildersleeve. Yeah.
And now meet Dick Calmer as Boston Blackie.
It's the Phil Harris Alice Faye Show, presented transcribed by the makers of Rexall drug products.
And now it's time to meet the men from the ministry.
Forces Radio and Television Service presents the Bob Hope Show with Les Brown and his band of renown, and yours truly, Bill Goodwin. And now here he is, Bob Hope.
Greetings, I'm Kevin Lauderdale.
Let's start off with some clever science fiction in the form of X-1. This episode, The Lifeboat Mutiny, is based on a short story by Robert Sheckley that originally appeared in the April 1955 issue of Galaxy magazine. No special notes. And now, after a couple of NBC ads, from September 11th, 1956, X-1, The Lifeboat Mutiny.
In just a moment, X-1, but first...
Boy, that kind of music went out with a handlebar mustache, didn't it? But the kind of wonderful melodies you'll hear on NBC's Bandstand are guaranteed to remain popular throughout the years. This is Bert Parks, your Bandstand MC. I'd like to invite you to spend 2 full hours each weekday morning with America's top name bands, groups like Guy Lombardo, the Dorsey Brothers, and Ralph Flanagan. They'll entertain you in person. So listen Monday through Friday to NBC Bandstand.
Now stay tuned for X-1 on NBC. After tonight's broadcast, X-1, the adult science fiction show, will not be heard until Wednesday, September 26th. It will be heard on Wednesdays thereafter. For the exact time, consult your local newspaper. And now, X-1.
Countdown for blast-off. X-5, 4... 3, 2, X-1, fire.
From the far horizons of the unknown come transcribed tales of new dimensions in time and space. These are stories of the future, adventures in which you'll live in a million could-be years on 1,000 maybe worlds. The National Broadcasting Company, in cooperation with Galaxy Science Fiction Magazine, presents
X-1.
This week, the police chiefs of the country are meeting in Chicago for the 63rd annual conference of the International Association of Chiefs of Police. Tonight, X-1 is proud to salute them as we present The Lifeboat Mutiny by Robert Sheckley.
Of course, we should have known better. In a way, we were asking for it, but frankly, we were short of credits and beggars can't be choosers. As a rule, I don't like second-hand equipment, not if I have to trust my life to it. But Joe, the interstellar junk man, can be pretty persuasive. He has an air of confidence when he walks down between the rows of antique jalopies on his lot and pats an airlock door lovingly or kicks at the ground gyros to show how firm they are. Joe exudes faith the way trees drip sap in the spring. And if you get too close, a little rubs off on you.
Yeah, you see? Solid as a rock. Look at that plating. I'm telling you, this boat is a real buy.
She looks pretty old.
Sure, she's old.
Now, don't give us that story about it belonging to a little old lady who used it to flip to church on Sundays.
Now, look, boys, I'm not trying to unload something on you. I don't stand to make a nickel on this, but tell me the truth. Did you ever hear sweeter engines? And look at those servos.
Pretty old.
And that hull. I bet it's 500 years old and not a spot of corrosion on it. I'm telling you, you're lucky. It's a coincidence, you two fellas coming in. You need a lifeboat. And sitting right here waiting for you. Like you was made for each other. Is this baby.
Well, she certainly does seem rather nice. What do you think about it, Dick?
It does look pretty good. It's about what we need for the ocean survey work on Trident. But you know Joe.
Ah, they just don't build them this way anymore. Look at that propulsion unit. You couldn't dent it with a trip hammer. And note the capacity of the cooling system.
It looks good, but some of these old machines, you know, I just want to make absolutely sure it's safe.
Safe? Safe. He asked me if it's safe.
Is it?
Now, step inside. Go ahead. Step inside. All right. Push that button. Right there on the instrument panel.
This one?
Hey. I am Lifeboat 324A.
Hey, the darn thing talks.
Yeah, and in English, too.
It's equipped with a universal translator. It's completely automatic. I told you, they just don't build them this way anymore. Go ahead. Push the button again.
I am Lifeboat 324A. My primary purpose is to preserve those within me from peril and to maintain them in good health. At present, I am only partially activated.
Could anything be safer? This is no senseless hunk of metal. This boat will look after you. This boat cares.
I don't know. The idea of an emotional machine always gets me. I can't even stand those robot maitre d's. They keep slobbering over you every time you go into a restaurant with their tubes just pouring kindness and consideration.
Ah, you're a reactionary. We'll take it.
You won't be sorry. Boys, you just bought yourselves a lifeboat.
Joe delivered this assurance in the frank and open tones that had helped make him a millionaire several times over. It wasn't that he was dishonest. Far from it. All the flotsam he collected from anywhere in the universe worked. But ancient machines often had their own idea of how a job should be done. They tend to get peevish when forced into another routine.
Al, there she goes, Lifeboat 324A. I got her down in the afterhold. I think she's in perfect condition. You know, it's just what we need for those oceans on Trident.
I hope so. The last thing I bought from Joe was an electric razor. Only it turned out that it came from Deneb 3, where they are slightly reptilian. And an electric razor is used to help them change their skin in the hot months. If you remember, I was in the hospital 3 months, and after the skin grafts, I don't know my ears from my elbow. This job we were on was to survey the planet Trident for a real estate speculator who bought it for subdivision. Trident was about the size of Mars, but with a far better climate. There was no native indigenous population, no poisonous plants, and no germ-borne diseases. As a matter of fact, apart from one small island and one small polar ice cap, the entire planet was covered with water. There was no real shortage of land. You could wade across some of Trident's several seas. Our firm had been hired to survey and plan a little mountain raising because the sector council frowned on selling building lots under 4 feet of water. We landed on Trident and launched the lifeboat.
Okay, I got the sandwiches in the water. Ready to cast off?
Aye, aye, sir. All mooring lines are on board.
All right, let's crank this swan boat up and get going.
Well, push that button.
Aye, aye.
I am Lifeboat 324A. My primary purpose is to preserve those within me from peril and to maintain them in good health. At present, I am only partially activated. For full activity, press button 2.
Oh, there it is, right next to the first one.
Well?
Something's going on back there. Sounds like motors warming up. Hey, that sounds like a short circuit somewhere. You know there's no wheel on this thing?
Oh, wait a minute. There's got to be some kind of tiller or controls.
Well, you look. That's all there are, two buttons.
Well, then maybe she controls telepathically.
I'll try it.
Hey, 324A, go ahead slowly.
Ah, there she goes. That's it.
Starboard a little.
Wait a minute. I still don't like the sound of that. I bet there's a short somewhere. I'm going down to look for it with a circuit tester.
Don't louse anything up. I like a boat that works this way. Gives me a sense of power.
Hey, 324A, full speed ahead.
Arnold disappeared into the bilge with a circuit tester, and I handled the survey. Actually, our machines did all the work, tracing the major faults in the ocean bottom, locating the most promising volcanoes. And when the survey was complete, the next stage would be turned over to the subcontractor. He would wire the volcanoes, seed the faults, and touch the whole thing off. After that, there'd be enough dry land on Trident for anybody. Now, by mid-afternoon, I figured we could knock off for a while. We ate our sandwiches, took a drink of water from the canteen, and then had ourselves a swim in Trident's clear, green water.
Hey, give me a hand up.
That was very refreshing.
Oh, yeah. I'll have to get this grease off with sandpaper, but I think I found the trouble. You see, the leads to the primary activator have been removed and the power cable's been cut.
Well, why would anyone do that?
Well, it might have been part of the decommissioning, but I got it hooked up now. Go ahead, hit the second button. Might as well have this thing working right.
Okay, here she goes.
I am Lifeboat 324A. I am now fully activated and able to protect my occupants from danger. Have faith in me. My action response tapes, both psychological and physical, have been prepared by the best scientific minds in all Drome.
Ah, that's more like it, huh? Gives you a feeling of confidence, doesn't it?
I suppose so. But where is Drome?
Gentlemen, try to think of me not as an unfeeling mechanism, but as your friend and comrade in arms. I understand how you feel. You have seen your ship go down, cruelly riddled by the implacable Hgen.
What ship? What's it talking about?
You have crawled aboard me, dazed, gasping from the poisonous fumes of water, half dead.
Oh, no, wait a minute. You mean that swim we took? You got it all wrong. We were just surveying.
Half dead, shocked, wounded, morale low. You were a little frightened, perhaps. And well, you might be, separated from the Drome fleet and adrift upon an alien planet. A little fear is nothing to be ashamed of, gentlemen. But this is war, and war is a cruel business, and we have no alternative but to drive the barbaric Hgen across space.
There must be a reasonable explanation for all this.
Probably an old television script got mixed up in its response bank.
We better give it a complete overhaul. We can't listen to that stuff all day.
Well, we're about a quarter of a mile from the island. Yeah, I'll tell you what. I'll take it down and clean the goo out of the contacts when we get there.
Hey. What's going on?
We're stopping. Hey. Hey, lifeboat.
Quiet. Calm. Trust in me. I am scanning the island.
What's he talking about, scanning me?
Better humor it. Lifeboat, that island's okay. We checked it personally.
Perhaps you did. But in modern lightning-quick warfare, drone senses cannot be trusted. They are too limited, too prone to interpret what they wish. Electronic senses, on the other hand, are emotionless, eternally vigilant, and infallible within their limits.
But there isn't anything there.
I perceive a foreign spaceship on the island.
Oh, that's our ship.
It has no drone markings.
Well, it hasn't any enemy markings either. I painted it myself.
In war, we must assume that what is not ours is the enemy's.
Oh.
I understand your desire to set foot on land again, but I take into account factors that a drone motivated by his emotions would overlook. Consider the apparent emptiness of the strategic bit of land. The unmarked spaceship put temptingly out for bait. The fact that our fleet is no longer in this vicinity.
All right, that's enough. Now, I'm tired of arguing with you. Go directly to that island. That's an order.
I cannot obey that order. You are unbalanced from your harrowing escape from death.
All right, enough of this nonsense. I'm just going to take that cutoff switch and...
Come to your senses, gentlemen. Only the decommissioning officer is empowered to turn me off. For your own safety, I must warn you not to touch any of my controls. You are mentally unbalanced. Later, when our position is safer, I will administer to you. Now my full energies must be devoted towards detection and escape from the enemy.
Where are we going?
To rejoin the drone fleet as soon as I can find it.
We sailed over the empty seas of Trident for the rest of the afternoon and far into the night. At about midnight, we sat in the cabin sharing our last sandwich. The lifeboat was still rushing madly over the waves, its every electronic sense alert, searching for a fleet that had existed 500 years ago upon an entirely different planet.
Why didn't I pack more sandwiches?
Do you ever hear of these drones?
Yeah, vaguely. They were non-human, lizard-evolved creatures. Mm. Yeah, they lived on the sixth planet of some little system near, Capella. The race died out over a century ago.
Mm-hmm. And the Hagen. What about them?
Also lizard, same story. Mm. It wasn't a very important war, you know. All the combatants are gone except this lifeboat, apparently.
And us. We've been drafted as drone soldiery. Do you think we can reason with this, Tub?
Oh, no, I don't see how. As far as this boat is concerned, the war is still on. It can only interpret data in terms of that premise.
It's probably listening in on us now.
No, I don't think so. Hmm? See, it's not really a mind reader. Its perception senses are geared only to thoughts aimed specifically at it.
Yes, sirree. They just don't build them this way anymore. Ooh, I wish I could get my hands on Joe.
Well, you know, it's actually a very interesting situation. The machine is acting very logically upon no longer existent conditions. Therefore, you could say that the machine is the, the victim of a systematized delusion.
You mean the lifeboat is just plain insane?
Well, I believe paranoia would be the proper designation. Ah, but it'll end pretty soon.
Why?
It's obvious. The boat's prime objective is to keep us alive. Our sandwiches are gone, and the only other food is on the island. I figure it'll have to take a chance and go back.
Gentlemen. At present, I am unable to locate the drone fleet. Therefore, I am turning back to scan the island again. Fortunately, there are no enemies in this immediate area, so I can devote myself to your care.
Oh, you see, it's about time you got around to us. We're hungry.
Feed us.
Of course. Immediately. There you are. On the tray.
What's that?
That looks like clay.
Oh, it smells like machine oil. Hey, what's it supposed to be?
That is giesel. Hmm? It's the staple diet of the drone people. I can prepare it in 16 different ways.
Oh, try it.
All right. It tastes like clay coated with machine oil. We can't eat that.
Of course you can. An adult drone consumes 5.3 pounds of giesel a day and cries for more.
Now listen, we are not drones. We are humans, an entirely different species. The war you think you're fighting ended 500 years ago. We can't eat giesel. Our food is on the island.
Ah, yes. Your delusion is a common one among fighting men. It is an escape fantasy, a retreat from an intolerable situation. Gentlemen, I beg you. Face reality.
You face reality, or I'll have you dismantled bolt by bolt.
Threats do not disturb me. I know what you've been through. Possibly you've suffered some brain damage from your exposure to poisonous water.
Poisonous?
To drones.
If absolutely necessary, I am also equipped to perform physical brain therapy. It is a drastic measure, but there can be no coddling in time of war. You see? You need not worry. All my scalpels are razor sharp and ready for immediate action.
Oh, scalpels, huh? Well, we're feeling better already. It's a fine-looking batch of Giesel, isn't it, Arnold?
Oh, delicious.
Nothing is too good for our boys in uniform.
Hmm.
Do try a little.
Oh, that's wonderful. Oh, that's delicious.
Good. I am moving toward the island now, and I promise you in a little while you will be more comfortable.
Why?
The temperature here is unbearably hot. It is amazing you haven't gone into a coma. Any other drome would have. Soon I'll have it down to drome norm of 20 degrees below zero. And now I'll play our national anthem.
Arnold?
What?
I'm cold.
Well, you should be very comfortable. Drones live at 20 below zero. We're drones and no back talk.
Those cooling tubes are all frosted up.
Yeah, I just wrote my name in frost in the porthole. Hey, wait a minute.
Hmm?
Wait a minute. I got an idea. Just follow my lead.
Why not? Lead on, fellow drone.
Give me the canteen.
What are you doing?
Just gonna get a little exercise. Gotta stay fit, you know.
That is true.
Here you are, boy. Catch!
Look out, that canteen's heavy.
Just throw it right back, boy. Just heave it right in. Come on, let's see your curve.
Be careful with that receptacle. It's filled with a deadly poison. Water.
Oh, we'll be careful. Here we go!
Bad shot, old man.
Oh, how careless of me. I seem to have broken the cooling tubes. Cooling fluid all over the floor.
I should have taken precaution against internal accidents. It won't happen again. But the situation is very serious. I cannot repair the cooling tube myself. I'm unable to properly cool the boat.
Say, that's tough. Now, if you'll just drop us on the island...
That is impossible. My first duty is to preserve your lives, and you couldn't live long in the climate of this planet. But I'm going to take necessary precautions to ensure your safety.
What are you going to do?
There is no time to waste. I will scan the island once more. If our drone forces are not present, we will go to the one place on the planet that can sustain drone life.
What place?
The southern polar ice cap. The climate there is almost ideal. 30 degrees below zero. And of course, I must guard against any further internal accidents. So, I will lock you gentlemen in the cabin.
Think.
I am thinking. Nothing's coming out.
Well, we've got to get off when he reaches the island. It'll be our last chance.
Now, look. We know his internal scanning isn't very good. When we reach the island, maybe we could cut his power cable.
Oh, you couldn't get within 5 feet of it. He's got an electric charge on all the controls.
I am now scanning the island.
Place looks fine today.
Oh, sure does. I'll bet our forces are dug in underground.
They are not. I scan to a depth of 100 feet.
Well, under the circumstances, I think we should examine it a little more carefully.
It is deserted. I cannot let you endanger your lives by going ashore. Drome needs her soldiers, especially sturdy, heat-resistant types like you.
We like this climate.
Spoken like a patriot. I know you must be suffering, but now I am going to the South Pole to give you veterans the rest you deserve.
Wait a minute. You don't understand. We're operating under special orders. We weren't supposed to disclose them to any vessel below the rank of Super Dreadnought. We're a suicide squad.
Yes, yes, that's right. Especially trained for hot climate war.
Our orders are to land and secure that island for the drone forces.
I didn't know that.
You weren't supposed to. After all, you're only a lifeboat.
Land us at once.
I couldn't guess, you know. All right. We'll head for the island.
Arnold, it's going to work.
Why not, as long as we tell him the truth?
The beach is only 50 yards away.
No. No.
No what?
I cannot do it.
What do you mean? This is war. Orders.
I know, but I cannot obey. A different type of vessel should have been chosen for this mission, but not a lifeboat.
You must think of our country. Think of the barbaric Hagen.
It is electronically impossible for me to carry out your orders. My prime directive is to protect my occupants from harm. That order is stamped on my every tape, giving priority above all others. I cannot let you go to your certain death.
You'll be court-martialed for this. I'll have you broken down to a dinghy.
I regret to say I must operate within my limitations. I must take you to the safety of the South Pole.
Listen, you crazy tin can. Let me at those controls. I'll...
Please, do not attempt any more destruction. I know how you feel.
Wait a minute, Arnold, old friend. Since we cannot accomplish our mission, we cannot ever again face our comrades. Death before dishonor. Hand me the canteen.
No. Don't. That's water. It is a deadly poison. Don't. Don't.
Too late. Arnold, it's your turn.
We, who are about to die, salute you.
We die for glorious Drome.
That goes for me, too.
Speak to me. Speak to me.
Lie still, you idiot.
There is no known antidote. If only I could contact the hospital ship. Speak to me. Are you still alive? Answer me. Here. Here. Perhaps if you eat some geisel. Dead. 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 I will now read the burial service. Great Spirit of the universe, take into your custody the souls of these your servants. Although they died by their own hand, still it was in the service of their country, fighting for home and hearth. Judge them not harshly for their impious deed. Rather, blame the spirit of war that inflames and destroys the spirit of all Drome. And now, by the authority vested in me, by the Drome fleet, and with all reverence, I commend their bodies to the deep.
Ow!
Shut up.
Accept them, O ocean, for many brave hearts are at slumber in the deep.
Float quietly.
What's the lifeboat doing? It's still hanging around.
Just pray the Dromes didn't believe in cremation.
Sleep quietly, brave spirits. I will now play the Drome national anthem.
Well, there she goes.
Where?
To the South Pole. To wait for the Drome fleet.
You have just heard X-1 presented by the National Broadcasting Company in cooperation with Galaxy Science Fiction Magazine, which this month features The Man Who Ate the World by Frederick Pohl. This is the story of a civilization which flowed with milk and honey, and of a man whose tragedy was that he had not drowned at birth. Galaxy Magazine, on your newsstand today. Tonight, by transcription, X-1 has brought you The Lifeboat Mutiny, a story from the pages of Galaxy written by Robert Sheckley and adapted for radio by Ernest Kenoy. Featured in the cast were Leon Janney, Mandel Kramer, William Redfield, and John McGovern. Your announcer, Fred Collins. X-1 was directed by Daniel Sutter and is an NBC Radio Network production.
A special announcement to the audience of X-1, the adult science fiction show. X-1 will not be heard next week, but will resume broadcasts at a new time on Wednesday, September 26th, and every Wednesday evening thereafter. For the exact time of the broadcast in your locality, remember to consult your local newspaper. The music of Tommy Tucker, live on Bandstand, weekday mornings on NBC Radio.
Now Jack Benny returns. In this episode, Jack is obsessed with the $4.75 he lost at a horse race. There's references to What's My Line? That was a game show where panelists guessed someone's occupation by asking questions. There was always a segment on the show where a very famous person would come on, and the panelists were blindfolded and had to guess who the guest was through yes and no questions. Hildegard was a very feminine nightclub singer. The gang sings a parody of Clancy Lowered the Boom, a tune, unsurprisingly, that Dennis Day had had a hit with. The original tells the tale of Clancy, an Irishman who never starts a fight, but whenever trouble shows its head, he sure finishes them by lowering the boom, his fists, presumably. Long time ago, high school and college kids used to tie foxtails to various parts of their cars. If you hop on over to YouTube, you can see the 1946 animated Disney short, All the Cats Join In, which features exactly that. From May 2nd, 1954, The Jack Benny Show, Jack loses $4.75 at the racetrack.
The Jack Benny Program, transcribed and presented by Lucky Strike.
Luckies taste better,
cleaner, fresher, smoother.
Luckies taste better,
cleaner, fresher, smoother. For Lucky Strike means fine tobacco, richer tasting, fine tobacco.
Luckies taste better,
cleaner, fresher, smoother. Lucky Strike, Lucky Strike.
This is Don Wilson, friends. Say, if you like poetry, here's something that may give you a little chuckle. Listen. I like the cigarette I smoke, a statement free from bunk or hoke. There is no reason for it, brother, except I don't like any other. That's straight from the typewriter of H.I. Phillips, the noted syndicated columnist. It's part of a statement that Mr. Phillips made regarding the cigarette he smokes, Lucky Strike. In another part of the statement, he said, long ago, I found Lucky's had the taste that suited me, and I've stuck to them through the years. I smoke Lucky Strike for enjoyment and relaxation. End of quote. Yes, indeed, the word enjoyment. That's the main thing you smoke for. It is all a matter of taste. And the fact of the matter is, Lucky's taste better. They just have to, because they're made of fine tobacco, and they're made better. For quite some time now, we've been asking smokers to be happy, go lucky. If you haven't tried Lucky's, why not take care of that next time you buy cigarettes? Believe me, Lucky's do taste better.
Lucky's taste better.
Cleaner, fresher, smoother. Lucky Strike! Lucky Strike!
The Lucky Strike program starring Jack Benny with Mary Livingston, Rochester, Dennis Day, Bob Crosby, and yours truly, Don Wilson. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight Jack Benny does another television program with his guest star, David Niven. Meanwhile, we have a radio show to do. So we bring you a man whose name for years has been the epitome of show business. A man who went from Waukegan to vaudeville.
From vaudeville to pictures.
From pictures to radio.
From radio to television.
And now, since he has no place else to go, would you please let him come into your home for just a half hour? Thank you. And here he is, Jack Benny.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Hello again, this is Jack Benny talking, and kids, you're absolutely right. I have been in show business a long time.
That's right. There aren't many performers who've been in the public eye as long as Jack.
Certainly, let's face it, I'm a popular star. I mean, everybody knows me.
Oh, sure.
couple of months ago, you were on What's My Line, and nobody guessed who you were.
Oh, was Jack the mystery guest?
No, they were looking right at him.
What are you laughing at?
When you walked past the panel, they thought you were Hildegard.
Well, anyway, we've got a show to do, so let's get on. Let's get on with... Oh, for goodness sake, what's all that racket? Hey, Bob! Bob Crosby, what's going on over there?
Oh, those are the carpenters, Jack. They're remodeling the studio.
Who authorized that?
Well, I don't know, but the boys in the band thought the acoustics could be improved, so they all chipped in their own money to have it done.
Why?
Well, last week the police were practically at the door before they heard the sirens.
The police? What do they want?
Well, they've been suspicious of Remley's electric guitar.
His electric guitar?
Mm-hmm. So they followed the cord, and at the other end, they found a telephone and a bookie.
Well, I hope this teaches them a lesson. He's always trying to figure out some way to bet on the horses.
I bet on the Kentucky Derby yesterday.
You did, Dennis?
Yeah, and then I went home and watched it on television.
When'd your horse come in?
On the 10 o'clock news. Boy, was he late.
Oh, fine.
The horse I like came in second. How did you have it figured, Jack?
Well, I didn't bet on the Derby, and I didn't watch it.
Oh, but, Jack, the Kentucky Derby's the biggest race of the year.
Look, Don, you can have your Derby and your Preakness and your Gold Cup and all the rest of them. Horse racing happens to leave me cold.
Say, Mary, what's the matter with him?
Oh, don't mind him, Don. He went out with us to Santa Anita 3 months ago. He lost, and he's been upset ever since.
Mary, I'm not upset, and I never was upset over losing.
Oh, you weren't, eh? Don, you should have seen the way Jack moped all the way home from Santa Anita.
Really, Mary? What happened?
Oh.
Well, Jack won on the sixth race, but he lost it all back and a little more on the last two. When the races were over, Jack, Dennis, and I were riding home in Jack's car. Rode for about 15 minutes in silence. Gee, it's fun going to races once in a while.
Yeah, I had a wonderful time. How much did you lose, Mr. Benny?
Oh, only $4.75. It was nothing.
Well, Jack, I'm glad to see you taking it like such a good sport.
Of course, Mary. What's $4.75? It's just the deposits on 237 Coca-Cola bottles. That's all. Da-dee-da-dee-da-dum, da-dee-da-dum, da-dum, da-dee-da-dum. How'd you make out, Dennis?
I won $8.
Oh, you won, huh? Well, I only lost $4.75. Did you win, Mary?
No, I lost $12.
Good, good. I mean, that's too bad.
Jack, I think you really are mad because you lost.
Oh, don't be silly, Mary. It doesn't bother me at all. Easy come, easy go. Now, let's forget it. Da-da-dee-da-dum, da-dee-da-dum, da-dee-da-da-da-da-dum. Rochester, did you lose much?
No, boss, I won $29.
Look, Rochester, you have no business betting on the races because you can't afford to lose.
But, boss, I told you I won. I won.
All right, just watch your driving.
Look, Jack, if losing bothers you so much, we won't discuss the races anymore.
Mary, I had completely forgotten about that $4.75 till you brought it up. Now, let's not mention it again. Da-da-da-da-dum, da-da-da-dum, da-dee-da-da-dum. Da-dum, da-dee-da-da-dum, da-da-da-dum. The only thing on my mind now is that I want to get home for dinner by 6 o'clock.
What time is it now?
4:75. I mean, 5:30. Now, look, once and for all, let's drop the subject.
You know, Jack, it was nice running into Benita and Ronald Coleman at the races.
Yeah, Ronnie won money, too, and he had the most peculiar system. No, he'd only bet on the English horses. Rochester, can you drive a little faster?
I'll try. Say, Mr. Benny, can I have tonight off?
I guess so. Why?
Well, I won $29 at the track, and I feel lucky. I thought I might go to the lodge and get into a poker game with some fellas.
Uh-huh.
Maybe I can win another $71, which will give me an even 100. And if I had $100 after all these years, I could propose to my girlfriend.
Wait a minute, Rochester. You mean to say that this would be the first time you've had $100?
This is the first time I've had 29.
Well, you should be a little more thrifty.
Are you going with the same girl, Rochester?
Yes, ma'am, Susie.
Gosh, you've been going with her for so many years. Tell me, Rochester, what does she look like?
Well, every time I look at her, I think of Lena Horne.
Oh, is she that beautiful?
No, I just like to think of Lena Horne.
Rochester, please pay attention to your driving, will you? I'm tired and I'm anxious to get home.
Yes, sir.
That's better.
Gee, we sure must be going fast. The foxtail just blew off the radiator cap. Lucky I caught it.
It's not a foxtail, and put it back on my head. Oh, Rochester, there's a man standing there motioning for us to stop. Pull over the curb.
Okay.
Yes?
Mister, do you know how to get to the public library?
No, I don't.
Well, you go back two blocks, turn left, and you can't miss it.
Well, that's the silliest thing I ever heard. Drive on, Rochester. Gee, I'm getting kind of thirsty.
Oh, if you're thirsty, Jack, there's an orange juice stand right up ahead.
Oh, yeah, look at that sign. All the orange juice you can drink for 10 cents.
Rochester!
Don't look at me. Mr. Benny stepped on the brakes.
From the back seat yet.
Well, all right, I'm thirsty.
Say, Jack, isn't that Bob Crosby and Charlie Bagby our piano player over there?
Yeah.
Say, Charlie, how'd you make out at the races today?
Great. I won $90.
$190. Big show off.
Hey, what's eating him, Mary? What's wrong with Bagby winning $90?
Oh, nothing, Bob. Jack's just upset because he lost $475. He even got mad at the horse.
I was not mad at the horse.
Then why did you shove your hand down his throat to get your lump of sugar back?
Oh, stop. I was cold. Now, look, kid. The silliest thing I ever said. Now, look, kids, I don't want to hear any more about my losing money. It isn't such a terrible thing.
Well, Jack, hey, kid.
Oh, it's Don Wilson.
Oh, yeah. Don, what are you doing out this way?
Well, it's such a nice day, I thought I'd take the Sportsman Quartet out for a ride.
Taking the quartet for a ride? Where's your car?
No car, piggyback.
Oh, yes, the tenor's sitting on the rumble seat. Hello, fellas. Say, Don, have you and the boys thought about a commercial for Sunday?
Oh, no, we haven't, Jack. But we'll work on it as soon as we get home.
Say, I know a song we can all sing for a commercial.
You do?
Yeah, it's Clancy Lowered the Boom.
Dennis, you've done that so many times. And anyway, I don't think that would make a good commercial.
Oh, yes, it will. And I've got parts for all of us. Here, this is the quartet's part. This is yours, Mary. And here's yours, Don, and Bob, and Rochester. Come on, let's go.
Wait a minute. There's no part for me.
You do your part on the violin.
But I haven't got my violin here.
Good. Well.
You'll take over my whole show pretty soon. That's all I need.
Come on, let's sing it.
Okay.
Oh, Clancy was a peaceful man, if you know what I mean. The cops picked up the pieces after Clancy left the scene. He never looked for trouble, that's a fact you can assume. Oh, nevertheless, when trouble would press, Clancy lowered the boom.
Oh, the Clancy! Oh, the Clancy! Whenever they got his Irish up, Clancy lowered the boom. Boom, 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 boom.
Now, Mr. Mr. Benny's very good at telling jokes and such. In fact, he's good at everything except perhaps a touch. One day I asked to borrow 10, was then I sealed my doom. I reached for the cash and quick as a flash, Benny lowered the boom.
Oh, Benny, oh, Benny. If ever you look in his pocketbook, Benny will lower the boom, 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 boom.
Now they can kid him all they please by saying that he's tight, but they should see him when he buys his dinner every night. He gives the girl a dollar, though you may think it strange, although the shade is tiny, he tells her to keep the change.
Oh, that Benny, oh, that Benny, if ever he spends a buck and a half, you'll know we're in for a boom, 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 boom.
I went to Mr. Benny's house and walked in through the door. There at my feet, a dollar bill was lying on the floor. I looked around but couldn't see nobody in the room. So, trusting my luck, I reached for the buck, then someone lowered the boom.
That was Benny, that was Benny. He scratches the middle of some poor fiddle and calls it love and bloom. Bloom, 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 bloom.
Now, when you want a cigarette, here's something I suggest. Why don't you light a Lucky Strike? You know you want the best. They're made of fine and light tobacco, that you will agree. So listen to Jack and buy a pack of LSMFT.
Oh, those Luckies, oh, those Luckies. Be happy and go with Luckies, you know they'll chase away your gloom.
Sure, and Clancy smokes them because they're cleaner, fresher, smoother, and better taste than true.
Dennis, that was very, very cute. I love those special lyrics. Now, come on, kids. Let's all have some orange juice.
Well, I've got to run along, Jack. I'll see you later.
Okay. Hey, Bob. Bob, wait a minute.
Uh-huh.
Say, Mary, watch me catch him. Oh, Bob.
Yeah, Jack?
Do you know how to get to the public library?
Well, sure. You go back two blocks, turn left, and you can't miss it. I ran into the same guy.
Oh, go on home. Well, we're getting close to home, kids, and I'm really tired. Rochester, what's wrong?
I think we're running out of gas.
But the gauge says full.
Don't go by that. It's painted that way.
That I don't understand at all. Anyway, there's a standard station, so pull in there.
Okay.
Rochester, honk the horn so the attendant...
Jack, look who it is.
Oh, yes.
Hello, Mr. Benny.
Mr. Kitzel. Mr. Kitzel, I didn't know you worked in a gas station.
It belongs to my brother-in-law. I'm only helping out. This is my first time.
Oh, the first time you ever worked in a gas station.
Yes.
How do you like it?
Ooh. Sometimes you meet such silly people.
You do?
Yeah, this morning a gentleman drove in with a brand new Cadillac and said, fill her up.
Uh-huh.
So I put in 582 gallons.
582 gallons?
I could have put in even more, but one window was open a little.
Mr. Kitzel, you're joking.
And Ed Leap.
I thought so. Now, Mr. Kitzel, I'd like to get some gas, too, but put it in the tank.
It's going in now.
Good, good.
Mr. Benny, while you're here, how about a grease job? I'll check your differential, universal joints, spring shackles, wheel bearings, and your axle bolts.
Mr. Kitzel, how'd you learn so much about what's under a car?
From trying to cross Hollywood Boulevard.
Oh, well, never mind the grease. How much do I owe you for the gas, Mr. Kitzel?
$4.75.
Here you are. Goodbye, Mr. Kitzel.
Thank you. Goodbye, Mr. Benny.
Well, come on, Rochester. We'll drop Miss Livingston and Dennis off and then go home. I want to get to bed. bed looks good. Gosh, what a relief to get this high-starch collar off. I only wore it one day and almost drove me nuts. I wonder how Hoover stood it all these years. Well, off with my sweater. Off with my shirt. Gosh, when I tell people I used to be a lifeguard, they laugh at me. Just look at those muscles, how they bulge, hard as rocks. I gotta stop wearing them in the shower. The buckles are getting rusty. It'll feel good to get my shoes off. Going to the track sure tires you out. Burns me up the way everybody thinks I'm mad because I lost $4.75. $4.75. I'll make that up in no time. One more guest appearance with Bob Hope and I'm all set. Gee, it's good to get in bed. Yes, sir.
Gosh, I'm tired. What a day.
Nothing like a good night's rest. Gosh, what a crowd at the track.
Oh, mister, would you like to buy a program?
A program, yes. How much is it?
$4.75.
Is that all?
Jack.
Oh, hello, Don. What are you doing at the track?
Oh, I love horses. In fact, when I was born, my father wanted me to be a jockey.
Oh, Don, that's ridiculous. A jockey's only supposed to weigh about 90 pounds.
That's what I weighed when I was born.
Oh, well, what do you weigh now?
475.
I gotta win today. I've gotta win. I gotta win today.
The horses are coming out on the track for the next race. Johnny Longdon looks nervous on correspondent. Eddie R. Carroll looks anxious on rejected. Ralph Neves looks calm on Imbros. Jack Benny looks crummy on television.
I do not. I gotta win today. I gotta win.
Hey, Bud. Bud.
Huh?
Come here a minute.
What?
Who are you betting on?
Imbros.
Uh-uh.
What?
Bet on orange juice.
Orange juice? Why?
Look at the odds. All you can drink for 10 cents.
Hey, wait a minute. You're Mary Livingston. You're not that tout. What are you trying to... Oh, look, there's Dennis. Dennis. Dennis.
Ah, you're confused, old boy. I'm Ronald Coleman. Now, let's see. I wonder if this horse is worth betting on.
Wait a minute. You only bet on English horses.
Quite. Now, I'd better find out if this one passes the test. Tell me, horse, are you English?
Well, I'll be darned. See, that gives me an idea. I'm going down to the paddock and talk to the horses. Here's a horse I'm going to bet on. Hello, horsey. You know, I bet a lot of money on you. Are you going to win today?
Am I?
Wait a minute. You're not a horse.
If you're a horse, how come you can talk?
I can't. The horse next to me is a ventriloquist.
Ventriloquist? How can a horse be a ventriloquist?
Yeah, how should I know? It's your dream.
What?
The race is about to start. Make your bets.
My bet. My bet. I gotta make my bet. I gotta win $4.75. Oh, darn it, the window is closed. I'll rap on it. Open the window. Open the window. What happened?
When you opened the window, the gasoline ran out.
Oh, here's the betting window. Mister, here's $10. Give me a ticket on library.
You got the wrong window. Go back two blocks and turn left.
Thank you.
Attention, please. There is only 1 minute in which to make your bets. You people who can't get to the window, follow the electric cord. It will lead you to a guitar player.
Oh, good. I'll get my bed down.
And there they go. Imbrose is in front. Rejected is second. Library is third. And Don Wilson is fourth, fifth, and sixth.
Fourth, fifth, and sixth?
He's running as an entry. Coming around the far turn, a library is first, correlation is second, Frank Remley is bottled in and he likes it.
Come on, library! Only two blocks more and turn to the left!
And now coming into the stretch, wait a minute, correlation is having trouble, correlation can't see the finish line, his blinkers are pitted.
Come on, library!
And now coming fast on the outside is Clancy. Oh, the Clancy! Oh, the Clancy!
Whenever he got his Irish up, Clancy lowered the boom.
Boom, 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 boom.
Come on, come on, boom, boom! Come on, boom, boom!
And now coming to the line of finish is Guayamo. Fisherman and James Session, and running right behind him is David Niven, who will be lobbying for his guest appearance tonight on Jack Benny's TV program.
Come on, Niven! Come on, Niven! Run! 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 If you don't win, I'll lose $4.75. I'll lose $4.75. Come on! Come on, run! Run! Run, Niven!
Boss!
Run! Run!
Boss!
Run! Huh?
Boss, you must have been dreaming about horses.
How do you know?
You're riding the bedpost.
Gee, Rochester, I just had the most exciting dream. Gosh, I won't be able to go back to sleep now. Get me some Ovaltine.
Yes, sir. By the way, Mr. Benny, after you went to bed, a special delivery came for you.
Special delivery? What was it?
A refund from the Income Tax Bureau.
How much? How much?
$4.75.
Oh, good. Never mind the Ovaltine. I can sleep now. Good night, Rochester.
Good night, boss.
Ladies and gentlemen, I will be back in a minute to tell you about my television show, which goes on tonight at 7 p.m. over the CBS network with my guest star, David Niven. But first, here's a very important announcement. It deals with one of our greatest national hazards, fire. Fire destroys millions of dollars worth of property and takes thousands of lives each year. Don't let your home be a fire trap. Make certain all electrical appliances are in order. Don't smoke in bed and be careful with inflammables. Don't give fire a place to start. Thank you. I'll be back in just a minute, but first here's a word from the sweetheart of Lucky Strike.
This is Dorothy Collins. Hi, everybody. You know, smoking enjoyment is all a matter of taste. And friends, the fact of the matter is, Lucky's taste better. One important reason for this is LSMFT. Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. Fine, naturally mild, good-tasting tobacco. And second, Luckies are made better. They're made round and firm and fully packed to draw freely and smoke evenly. Golly, that's the whole thing in a nutshell. Truly fine tobacco in a better-made cigarette. That's the whole Lucky Strike story. That's why you can be sure, sure every time you open a pack of Luckies, that you'll enjoy a better-tasting smoke. For smoking enjoyment is all a matter of taste. And the fact of the matter is, Luckies taste better. They're cleaner, fresher, smoother. Pick up a pack or two next time you buy cigarettes. Be happy. Go Lucky. You'll agree. Luckies taste better. Luckies taste better.
Cleaner, fresher, smoother.
Luckies taste better.
Cleaner, fresher, smoother. For Lucky Strike means fine tobacco, richer tasting fine tobacco.
Luckies taste better.
Cleaner, fresher, smoother. Lucky Strike! Lucky Strike!
Ladies and gentlemen, tonight I'm doing my television program, and as I said before, my guest star will be... Here he comes, David Niven. Yeah, I'll be jolly well seeing you soon. Good night, folks.
The Jack Benny Show tonight was written by Milt Josephsberg, John Tackerberry, Al Goldman, Al Gordon, and produced and transcribed by Hilliard Marks. The Jack Benny program is brought to you by Lucky Strike, product of the American Tobacco Company, America's leading manufacturer of cigarettes.
This is the CBS Radio Network. And KNX AM and FM Los Angeles.
That's your old-time radio fix for this week. I hope you enjoyed yourselves. Be sure to subscribe to The Chronic Rift on iTunes or visit us frequently at chronicrift.com.
What a voice. What a voice. Simply means ink. A dink-a-doo. A dink-a-dee. Good night, folks. Signing off.
Around the first turn, stewage hand is still in front. Cabbage is second by a head.
Cabbage by a head!
Beautiful Linda is third, and a Beetlebum.